Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to our second Link and Learn webinar of 2020. Since 2009, Deloitte has decided to open its knowledge resources to the professionals of the financial services industry's community. These sessions are designed to provide you with valuable insight on today's critical trends and the latest regulations impacting your business. We're delighted to have you join us for today's session on investment management tax and the tax outlook for 2020. We have a great team of specialists lined up to talk to you today. From the UK, we have Sheelan Shah, who is a tax partner in our London firm. Sheelan is a tax partner in Deloitte's asset management practice. She has advised investment managers and institutional investors on setting up tax-efficient investment fund structures in the UK and overseas, providing advice from an investment and an investor perspective, including compliance and other tax issues. Joining Sheelan in the UK is Ian Ahkong. Ian is a director with experience in both the investment management and real estate industries. He provides investment management tax advice to institutional investors, which include global investment funds, pension schemes, and sovereign wealth funds in relation to equity, bond, and pooled fund investments. Ian's experience covers a wide range of tax support through the whole investment lifecycle and at investment, fund, and investor levels. From our Luxembourg office then, we have Nenad. Nenad is a director in the cross-border tax department in Deloitte in Luxembourg and regularly assists banking and asset management businesses on a broad range of local and international tax matters, including, amongst others, corporate taxation, transactional tax planning, operational taxes, and taxation of investment funds. Finally, I will be covering the Irish tax aspects today. My name is Rachel Hanley and I'm a manager in the corporate tax department of the Dublin office. I've been with the firm over 8 years now, and I specialise in the areas of investment management, structured finance, and banking. Our agenda today, then, is absolutely jam-packed. We are going to kick off with the UK team, who are going to provide us with an update on the UK non-resident capital gains tax regime, UK non-resident landlord regime changes coming down the tracks, and the impact of Brexit on withholding tax. I will then take you through Finance Act 2019 changes, covering all of the changes introduced by Finance Act which are relevant to the funds industry. Finally, Nenad will take you through mandatory disclosure, or DAC 6 as it's more commonly known, and will also provide a couple of updates on global withholding tax. So without further ado, I will hand over to Sheelan and Ian to kick off today's presentation.
Hi all, thanks so much. So, from a UK tax perspective, Sheila and I would like to touch on three main areas and when looking ahead for 2020. First being the UK non-resident capital gains tax provisions, second, the UK non-resident landlord regime, and lastly, the potential impact of Brexit on withholding. So, firstly, moving on to slide seven, as a recap, there have been significant changes in recent years to UK tax law. In particular, for the taxation of non-resident investors investing into UK property. The changes in the UK non-resident capital gains tax rules from April 2019 and the forthcoming changes to the UK non-resident landlord rules from April 2020 are the most significant changes to the taxation of UK property in a generation. These are key considerations for real estate funds investing into UK property, but then also for the purposes of this webinar, we will touch on these areas in the context of traditional equity investment funds. Whilst these funds would not be investing directly in UK property, there could still be some UK tax exposure through indirect investments. So moving on to slide eight. Slide eight provides a high-level overview of the UK non-resident capital gains tax rules. This will continue to be an area of consideration throughout 2020. In summary, the new rules apply to gains accruing from April 2019. The rules bring UK non-residents into the charge of the normal UK CGT rules. Tax charges can arise both on direct and potentially indirect disposals subject to various conditions. And the implications of being caught within these new rules are that tax reporting and payments may be required. So further looking at the indirect charge, which is the area of more relevance for equity investment funds, this will apply when two conditions are met. First, the interest being disposed, for example, a listed equity, needs to be 75% UK property rich. The second, the non-UK resident needs to hold a substantial indirect interest. This is defined as a 25% or more holding. It should be noted that this second condition is switched off or goes down to 0% if the interest being disposed of is in a collective investment vehicle or CIV. This is why the indirect charge is particularly relevant for equity investment funds. So to bring this to life, Sheelan will just quickly run through the example on the slide.
Okay. Hello, everybody. Yes, so this has somewhat caught the traditional funds industry by a little bit of surprise, because the rules were meant to be very much focused on, you know, investment in direct UK property and particularly property funds more widely. But just to take you through an example here, if you have a Luxembourg fund range, the strategy is just to invest in equities and funds as well. To the extent that you are invested in a UK property rich investment, there is the potential for you to be caught within the new rules and therefore subject to capital gains tax in the UK going forward. So why is this important? The reason is UK REITs are regarded as being a UK property rich in most instances. And there are a number of funds, both in Luxembourg, but across the globe, that invest in equities widely and commonly also invest in UK REITs because they are a listed equity portfolio holding, essentially. So unfortunately, with REITs being within the definition of having generally 75% UK property richness, they will be caught by these rules. So it's not just for direct property holdings or property funds that you need to look out for. And Ian's going to take you through some more detailed considerations over the next few.
Indeed. So the question is, what is a CIV? So slide 9 outlines that in a bit more detail. And so broadly, a CIV is a collective investment scheme as defined by UK legislation, an alternative investment fund, or AIF, a UK real estate investment trust, REIT, and overseas equivalents of UK REITs. So the implications of being of CIV, as mentioned, well, when considering the indirect charge, interest in a CIV will mean that the 25% holdings threshold is switched off. In addition, a CIV will be treated as a deemed company for the purposes of the UK non-resident capital gains tax rules.
So just to bring that back to the earlier example, the UK REITs fall into the definition of collective investment vehicles, which is why a number of traditional funds invested in these will be impacted regardless of whether they have a 1% interest or a 5 or 30% interest, because 25% threshold does not.
Indeed. So for any fund that does hold portfolio interest, then they really should be considering these rules, in particular in relation to their UK REITs and UK PAIF, so property alternative investment fund investments. In addition, for funds with fund of fund strategies, they should be considering these provisions on for each of their investments on a case-by-case basis, as the indirect charge could potentially apply anywhere up the investment chain and could impact them directly as well. Finally, tax treaty relief may be available. However, this would be subject to the respective treaty and the specific tax. So for example, the UK-Luxembourg tax treaty does include relief for UK capital gains tax. However, a Luxembourg fund may not necessarily be able to gain access to the treaty and therefore be able to benefit from the protection. So it very much does depend on the specific facts and circumstances. Moving on to slide 10, so this slide outlines some key points in respect of reporting and compliance. Now, just running through some of the key points here, the rules, as I said, only applies on disposals from April 2019. A non-resident is required to register with HMRC within 3 months from the date of the first chargeable disposal. A CIV can make filings on a 12-month accounting period basis. Tax filings will need to be made within 12 months of the accounting period end date. And investment portfolios include holdings with potential UK tax charge. Where investment holdings include potential tax charges, we've been working with our clients to consider deferred tax provisions and potential accruals in order to ensure that investment funds are appropriately priced and the NAV is correct. So that's the UK non-resident capital gains tax provisions as an overview. Next, we wanted to touch on the UK non-resident landlord regime.
So the UK non-resident landlord regime, or referred to as was actually introduced basically to non-resident investors that had exposure to UK property investments. And the regime essentially was focused on taxing rental income that derived from those investments and was always currently under what's known as the income tax basis in the UK. Now, as a result of a number of these changes, particularly given that the UK government have decided to tax non-residents on capital gains tax by investing in UK property, which was never the case historically, the capital gains taxation, as Ian has just described, falls within the corporate tax regime, or the CT regime in the UK. But as a result of that, what the government have also done is the taxation of rental income profits, which were previously under the NRL regime, are also being brought into line with the CT regime as of April 2020, so April this year. Now, this means that, you know, as we touched on right at the start, it is a significant change across the board on how income from UK property is going to be subject to tax for non-resident investors. I'm not proposing to go into a lot of detail in each of the rules and how they're going to impact taxation, but wanted to alert to all the listeners on this webinar that to the extent that you have, as a non-resident, you are invested in UK property directly or managed property funds that have UK property investments, then these rules are definitely likely to impact you as of April this year. It is quite a big change in terms of taxation under the income tax rules versus these corporate tax rules. Some examples I'm going to just bring out are interest deductibility. It is one of the key issues that's going to impact these structures. Under the previous regime, interest deductibility was allowed under more general principles of arm's length taxation. Going forward, under the corporate tax regime, there are much more stringent rules aligned with a number of other European countries around how much interest can be deducted for internal and external debt within structures. And that's going to have a huge impact on many structures that previously enjoyed fairly generous and healthy deductions of interest, which reduce the liability tax on UK rental income. Another area that's going to require a fair bit of thought and consideration whether any restriction might apply are the potential for hybrids within a structure that, again, could have an impact on a number of costs that may otherwise have been deducted against UK rental income under the non-resident landlord regime currently in place. So as I said, I don't intend to go into any specific details here, but would recommend that if you may have anything that could be impacted by these new rules, please feel free to contact us here at Deloitte or seek advice or alternative advice, as this is something that should be considered this year during the transitional period in preparation
for the next reporting cycle under the corporate tax regime. And that probably brings us to an end in terms of the taxation of NRL transition to CT, as well as non-resident capital gains tax in the UK.
Great. So finally, the last area that we want to touch on from the UK team is the potential impact of Brexit on withholding tax. Now, just as a bit of a caveat, this is in particular in relation to dividend withholding tax. So as background, for anyone that isn't aware, the UK left the European Union from 1st of February 2020. Now, there will be a transitional period up until 31 December 2020. And during that period, the UK government and the European Union have stated that European law will continue to apply as it was at the end of January. So as you progress through the transitional period and get further into the detail, questions have arisen on whether domestic withholding tax exemptions that many equity funds currently make use of continues to apply. In this context, Deloitte has carried out a high-level review to determine if any further considerations are needed in this area. And by all means, happy to catch up and discuss this with anyone if of interest outside of this webinar. A point to note in advance, as I said, is that we have mainly focused or solely focused on dividends. And these are dividends to UK investment funds. The reason being is because dividends from the UK to any recipient outside of the UK is not subject to UK withholding tax. So in terms of slide 14, this is providing a high-level overview. If you just go back one slide. So this is just providing a high-level overview of the considerations and why we're looking at the implication of Brexit on dividend withholding tax. So just starting off with the pre-Brexit position, many UK investment funds could enjoy a number of domestic withholding tax exemptions from European countries, provided certain conditions were met. These conditions could be one or more of the following three. For example, adherence to EU law, for example, UCITS, being resident of an EU or EEA member state, and finally, the existence of an information exchange agreement between the respective countries. So point one, as mentioned, throughout the transitional period, this will continue to apply because regulations such as the UCITS regulations will continue throughout the transition period. Point three is a sheer statement of fact based on the respective double tax treaties. Point two is the point in question here, seeing as the UK has legally left the European Union as of 1 February 2020. So the question here is, are there protections throughout the transitional period, which means that domestic exemptions will continue to apply? And then just finally, post-Brexit, without any further consideration or further agreement, all of the domestic exemptions that we are considering will effectively fall away, and UK funds will need to rely on reliefs available through double tax treaties. So moving on to the next slide, slide 15, what we have done here is just provided a sample of the countries we've looked at as part of this review, just to give a bit of flavor of the various outcomes we're seeing. This table in particular just looks at UK UCITS and UK pension funds. And the questions here that we've asked ourselves and asked throughout our Deloitte network is, firstly, is there a domestic exemption that requires an EU or an EE member state requirement? That's either not applicable, yes or no. And if there is a EU member state requirement, is there some form of local protection that could mean the status quo remains? And that could be either legislation or a public statement. In most cases, in pretty much all cases, there is no legislation, but there may be public statements issued by the local government to say that that EU exemptions will continue to apply. Now, the only risk here is that many of these statements do not actually make specific statement to the EU member statement requirement. So without any testing, which will happen as we go through the transitional period, this is still all up in the air slightly. So as you can see, with countries such as Greece or Portugal, you can see that there is very much, no protection. So our network believes, we're expecting domestic exemptions to not apply, subject to obviously how custodians and sub-custodians will apply that in practice. Some countries very much expected that domestic exemptions will continue to apply. But then we also have situations such as Austria and Sweden, where, say, for example, Austria, for UK pension funds, it looks like protections are in place. However, Deloitte believes that there could be a risk. Domestic exemptions could fall away later during the transition period as the exemption continues to be tested. Equally, Sweden, whilst there is no protection out there at the moment, we believe that it's more likely the exemption will apply going forward. But again, this is subject to testing. So that's just an overview of the potential impact of Brexit on dividend withholding tax. And I'll pass back to Rachel.
Perfect. Thank you so much, Ian and Sheelan, for that. So then moving on to Irish tax matters, and I'm just going to take you through a very quick run through of the relevant updates from Finance Act 2019. So those may be then just to recap a little bit. The Budget 2020 speech was delivered by the Minister of Finance on the 8th of October 2019, with the detailed finance bill following thereafter. Finance Act 2019 was then signed by the President of Ireland on the 22nd of December 2019, which actually makes a change from the past 2 years where he signed the Finance Act on Christmas Day. So, as you can see laid out on the slide there, there were a couple of changes in Finance Act 2019 that are relevant to the funds industry and which I'd like to talk to you briefly about today. So these are, firstly, amendments to Section 110, the widening of Ireland's transfer pricing regime, the introduction of anti-hybrid legislation, the introduction of DAC 6 legislation, and amendments to the IRF regime. I'll also give a brief update on the status of interest limitation rules at the end. So firstly then to the updates to Section 110. So I suppose we did have some changes to Section 110. To be honest, these came as a bit of a surprise to the industry, as it wasn't until the day before the finance bill was released that word got out that changes were to be made. Nevertheless, there have been some changes. The first of these was to significantly widen the definition of a specified person. So the legislation now provides that broadly a person has control of a company where that person has the power to secure voting power in relation to that company or significant influence over the first mentioned company and holds directly or indirectly more than 20% of the issued share capital of the company, 20% of the principal value of any profit participating securities issued by that company, or the rights to 20% of the interest or other distribution payable in respect of any profit participating securities. The changes to the specified person definition may result in a number of investors in securitization vehicles who previously were not considered specified persons now falling within the definition of a specified person, and thus calling into question the availability of a deduction of any profit participating interest paid to those investors. Where, however, the investors are fully taxable entities in an EU double tax treaty country, these changes should not have an effect on the availability of a deduction for the profit participating interest paid to such investors. However, those changes could have a significant impact where this is not the case. So for anyone on the line who is interested in this and think that this might impact their structure, certainly we'd be happy to talk to you after this webinar. The second change then was a widening of the definition of specified person to include a person to whom loans or advances held by the qualifying company were made. To be honest, we would not expect this change to have a significant effect. As the change noted on this slide, many people would be of the view before now that under the previous definition, where the loans were made by the Section 110 itself to the person, or whether the Section 110 held the loans originated by another party to that person, that the person was caught either way by the definition of specified person. So hopefully not too many surprises here. Additional changes were then made to widen the general anti-avoidance provisions, and this slide here just outlines the previous and the current wording of the definition. In summary, the anti-avoidance test is now subjective in nature and looks to the motive of the taxpayer. So this represents a significant change to the anti-avoidance provisions included within Section 110, and the impact should be considered by all securitisation vehicles. So really, we'd recommend that in all cases, the company should have documentation in place supporting the commercial rationale behind the setup of the company as a Section 110 vehicle, as well as the reasoning for including a profit participating element in the structure. This will be particularly important in relation to any new Section 110 vehicles. So then, moving on, I suppose, to another change within the Section 110 that was specifically relevant, I suppose, for transfer pricing. So Finance Act introduced a number of changes to Ireland's transfer pricing rules. The changes included increases to the scope of Irish transfer pricing rules to include non-trading transactions. However, a new provision was included within Section 110, which ensures that the new transfer pricing rules introduced in Finance Act 2019 do not apply to profit participating notes issued by a Section 110 vehicle. Specifically, the legislation notes that in computing the profits or gains of a qualifying company, Section 835C, which is a section of the legislation that provides for Irish transfer pricing rules, shall not apply to any amount deducted by a qualifying company for any interest or other distribution paid in respect of a security referred to in subsection 4, which would be your PPN. Now, while I say that PPNs are not within transfer pricing rules, I guess I would just like to make the point that there is already an arm's length requirement in Section 110, specifically in order to be considered a qualifying company. All transactions entered into by a Section 110 company must be by way of bargain made at arm's length, with the exception of the PPN. So therefore, whilst PPNs have been scoped out of the new transfer pricing rules, the arm's length requirement does already exist. So really, 110 still may be within the remit of revised transfer pricing documentation requirements. These changes should therefore be considered in the context of those companies as well as other companies. The changes to Ireland's transfer pricing regime, however, should not apply to Irish funds, as their profits or gains are not chargeable to tax. So then again, to the transfer pricing more specifically, I suppose, as I mentioned, there was a widening of the Irish transfer pricing rules. These changes were brought into the legislation, I suppose, to bring our legislation up to the standard of the 2017 OECD guidelines. So the current rules therefore catch items now such as non-trading transactions, grandfathered transactions, capital transactions where the value is greater than 25 million, and these rules are effective from 1 January 2020. So it is just something to bear in mind, because this is quite a significant change for Ireland. Moving on then to the anti-hybrid legislation, this was introduced as a result of ATAD 2. So I suppose really tax system arbitrage as a result of exploiting differences in the treatment of certain payments and entities cross-border can, as you know, lead to tax advantages. So to counteract this, the European Union's Anti-Tax Avoidance Directive mandated a number of changes to be made to the domestic laws of all EU member states. Irish draft legislation included within the recent Finance Act seeks to now implement these measures. Broadly, the anti-hybrid rules apply to transactions between associated enterprises and aim to prevent taxpayers from exploiting differences in countries' tax systems by obtaining a double deduction for the same expense or by securing non-taxation of income that has been deducted for tax purposes elsewhere. The two key ways in which the anti-hybrid rules achieve this are by either disallowing the expense deduction by the payer or by imposing taxation of the income in the hands of the recipient. I don't really want to dwell on this in too much detail as the legislation is rather complex, but I just want you all to be aware that where there is a mismatch outcome, under the headings outlined on this slide, corrective actions must be taken. It is, however, worth noting that in respect of Irish funds, many of the anti-hybrid provisions only apply to companies within the charged corporation tax, and as such, we would not expect these rules to impact on Irish funds, which under Section 739C of the Irish tax legislation are exempt from corporation tax. Moving then briefly to DAC 6, so I suppose this is an area I won't dwell on too much as Nenad is going to cover this later on in the presentation. However, just to make a few quick points on this from an Irish tax perspective. So DAC 6 is the sixth European directive on administrative cooperation in tax matters. It was transposed into Irish law as part of Finance Act 2019. At a high level, DAC 6 will require intermediaries, including funds and asset managers, to identify and report potentially aggressive tax arrangements. Though whilst it is aimed at aggressive tax arrangements, the legislation is drafted even wider than that. The reporting is retrospective, and therefore all transactions from the 25th of June 2018 must be reported by the 1st of August 2020. Further reporting will then be required monthly, with the first monthly reporting required by Irish Revenue on 31st of August 2020. So in Ireland at the moment, we are still awaiting guidance as to exactly how Irish Revenue would like these returns to be filed. What we do know is that it will be electronically. However, we still don't know exactly what format they require, but hopefully we'll be seeing that draft guidance in the coming months. The IRF regime then. So I suppose Finance Act introduced a number of changes to Ireland's Irish real estate fund regime. The changes introduced are targeted at structures which are debt funded, such that the interest payable on the loans reduces the IRF profits. Broadly, an IRF will fall within the scope of these new provisions where the debt is incurred by the IRF and or by its property financing costs exceed certain thresholds. Where these rules apply, the IRF will be deemed to have received an amount of income to be calculated by reference to specific formulas included in the legislation, which will be subject to tax, Schedule D, Case 4, at a rate of 25%. In addition, a further change was introduced in Finance Act, such that any expenses taken into account in computing the profits of the IRF, which were not wholly and exclusively laid out or expended for the purposes of the IRF business, will now be deemed to be an amount of income received by the IRF, which, as above, will be subject to tax under Schedule D, Case 4. There is an exclusion from the above provisions where some or all of the income deemed to arise to the IRF relates to third-party debt. Where this is the case, the amount to be subject to tax will be reduced by the amount of income which would have been charged to tax had the debt consisted solely of third-party debt. So really, IRFs make up a very small percentage of the overall funds industry, but where you do find you have an IRF, these new rules will be very, very relevant to you. So I just, as I mentioned, want to touch very, very briefly on interest limitation. So as you'll all be aware, the Anti-Tax Avoidance Directive included measures to require the introduction by member states of interest limitation rules. And broadly, I suppose these rules are designed to limit the ability of companies to deduct borrowing costs when calculating taxable profits. So these rules were intended to be implemented by 1 January 2019 by EU member states. However, it was possible to seek a derogation where you felt that you had equally effective rules in place already. So Ireland did seek this derogation and they were in discussions with the EU Commission on this point. Had that been successful, I suppose, this would have resulted in a deferral of the implementation until 1 January 2024. However, it's now our expectation that these rules will actually be introduced effective 1 January 2021. So hopefully we will see draft legislation, if not sometime over the summer this year, certainly as part of the budget later in this year. So I suppose that's really a very quick whistle-stop tour of the developments coming out of Finance Act 2019. I appreciate there's quite a lot in there, certainly a couple of complex pieces in particular around the hybrids. So absolutely happy to take offline any questions that anyone might have after this webinar. I'll now then just pass the mic to Nenad, who will take you through DAC 6 in more detail and some global withholding tax updates.
Thank you, Rachel. So to give you, we'll spend the next couple of minutes on DAC 6. So to give you a bit of more background over, you know, about where it comes from, as other another DAC initiative, DAC 2 specifically, DAC 6 is derived from OECD initiative. In this case, the OECD BEPS action plan. If you could move on to the next slide, Rachel, that would be really good. So as you may know, a couple of years ago, the OECD came up with a 15 actions plan to combat tax avoidance and aggressive tax planning. Action 12 of that action plan was mandatory disclosure rules that basically obligated certain intermediaries, typically tax advisors, tax lawyers, to disclose tax schemes that were seen as aggressive to their home country tax authorities. So the as with the Common Reporting Standard, which is also an OECD-led initiative, the European Commission was inspired kind of by the BEPS action plan and transposed the Action 12 into create a directive out of Action 12, which gave us DAC 6. So DAC 6, as its name suggests, is the sixth iteration of the EU directive on administrative cooperation. This is a catch-all directive that covers all kinds of exchange of information regimes within the EU. As the Action 12, it obligates EU-based intermediaries to identify and to disclose certain cross-border reportable arrangements or transactions. Now, there are two important terms when it comes to DAC 6. First one is intermediary. So in essence, what you will find in the directive is that there are two types of intermediaries, the active ones, or what they call also as promoters, and the passive ones, which are also called service providers. So the first category of intermediaries is basically people and entities that are in the business of providing tax advice. So again, the big four firms, tax lawyers, tax advisors, and that kind of businesses. So these are almost always considered as intermediaries within the meaning of the directive, and therefore subject to this new reporting regime. What is new is that the directive also covers passive intermediaries. So basically any entity or person that provided that indirectly aid, assistance, or advice with respect to the setting up of that arrangement. And that could be, for instance, the case of a bank or any financial institution that opens an account and maintains an account that is used by the account holder in the context of a tax scheme. So if the bank is aware, if the bank knows that that account is being used in the context of a aggressive tax scheme within the meaning of DAC 6, that bank becomes an intermediary and again becomes subject to the new reporting regime. So that's one important term under DAC 6. Another one is the definition of the cross-border arrangement. So as its name suggests, it has to have a cross-border element. If it's a purely domestic transaction, domestic arrangement, this falls out of scope of DAC 6. It has to have a cross-border character. If you could move on to the next slide, Rachel. So I kind of already explained very briefly what is it about. It's basically a new tax reporting regime obligating intermediaries to report potentially aggressive tax arrangements, so not illegal, but aggressive. The kind of aggressivity of an arrangement is measured by reference to 15 hallmarks or indicators of aggressiveness, so to say. The idea of these hallmarks is to have a kind of an objective assessment of what is perceived as aggressive and what is not perceived as aggressive. So the main idea is that as long or as soon as one or several hallmarks are present in a given transaction, a given arrangement, that makes that transaction arrangement reportable for DAC 6 purposes. The reporting is done by tax intermediaries, which can include investment funds, management companies, or even investment advisors, some case custodian banks. So reporting is done by these intermediaries to their home country tax authorities, which will then exchange the information with the other tax authorities within the EU. So a couple of dates that are important when it comes to DEC 6. The first one is basically 25th of June, 2018. So as you may see here, the directive has a retroactive effect in the sense that it obligates intermediaries to identify past transactions, past arrangements implemented since 25th of June, 2018, and to report those arrangements in one go by the 31st of August, 2020. So in 6 months' time or so. So the deadline for transposing the directive into domestic law was 31st of December, 2019. 10 or so countries were not able to transpose it on time. Luxembourg was one of the countries that didn't transpose it on time. So as we speak now, we don't have a final law yet. We, based on the latest discussions we have had with the Ministry of Finance and with the tax authorities, it looks like we're going to get something in March or April this year, so quite late. The effective entry application will be on the 1st of July 2020. So this is the date from which intermediaries will have to identify reportable arrangements and report those arrangements within 30 days of the discovery of that arrangement. The reporting will be done electronically, so there will be an XML file. We don't have the schema yet. We know what kind of information will be found in that file, but we don't have the format yet. There is a provision in the directive that, according to which, if there are several intermediaries linked to a specific arrangement, specific transaction, it is possible that only one intermediary files the DEC 6 report, avoiding the other ones for the other ones to report. This is, however, subject to some stringent rules. Any intermediary must be able to prove that an arrangement has been indeed submitted or reported by another intermediary within the defined time frame. If you can move on the next slide, Rachel. So in terms of practical impacts for the fund industry, the way the hallmarks are drafted or written give rise to various interpretations, but this is basically how we at Deloitte assess DEC 6 for the fund industry. We tend to separate kind of impacts in two categories. First, when it comes to the asset managers groups entities, so the ManCo, the investment advisor very often, and that kind of, so the group and not the funds, there are certain hallmarks that could potentially make reportable certain transactions, certain intragroup financing transactions, certain corporate reorganizations, transfers of functions, mergers, that kind of stuff, which very often could be done not for tax reasons, but for pure, business reasons, but still having a strict reading of the hallmarks, we would such transactions, such arrangements would fall in the definition of a reportable arrangement, therefore be reportable for DEC 6. So very often group entities would be on these kind of transactions, say cross-border mergers or transfers of functions. You would probably be advised by a tax advisor, in which case the responsibility to report the transaction would fall not on the asset manager, but on your tax advisor. If you don't have a tax advisor, if you do these transactions without any external tax advice, or if your tax advisor benefits from professional privilege, and certain lawyers will benefit from professional privilege, so by law they will not be able to report under DEC 6. Only in those cases will the asset manager and the affiliated entities have to kind of self-assess and report themselves to their home country tax authorities. Now, the second category of impacts on the product side, we tend to separate mainstream funds, so typically UCITS funds and UCITS-like funds, and alternative funds, typically private equity real estate funds. When it comes to mainstream funds, the risk, DEC 6 risk is obviously lower. However, there are certain risks that are worth pointing out. And what I'm going to say here is not something that is carved in stone. We don't have a final final view on that. There is no guidance from the tax authorities whatsoever. But for instance, something that could be at risk is securities lending transactions. If those transactions result in withholding tax savings, withholding tax arbitrage, there could be, there is a risk that the fund and by extension, the management company, the investment advisor, potentially even the custodian, would be qualified as either a relevant taxpayer or intermediary within the meaning of DAC 6 and therefore be required to report that kind of transaction. The same goes with investments in certain derivative instruments, such as CFDs, certain forwards, certain repos, that may have as an effect to achieve withholding tax savings. Something also that is of relevance when it comes to the funds, this is more on the investor side. If a fund has an investor or if the investor is, say, non-compliant with FATCA and CRS, if the fund has difficulties to identify the beneficial owner or the controlling person of a passive entity for FATCA or CRS purposes, the fund would, in principle, need to report that kind of investors also for DAC 6 purposes. And when it comes to the alternative funds, well, these funds are almost always structured from a tax perspective. It doesn't mean that these structures are perceived as aggressive under DAC 6. It doesn't mean that there are hallmarks that are, you know, present in this kind of structures. But still, because there is almost always a tax structure, what we strongly recommend is to review those structures, at least those implemented since 25th of June 2018, in order to make sure that they are reportable, not reportable. Again, these structures, normally there is very often or always, almost always an external tax advisor providing advice, providing assistance with the setting up of such structures. And typically, it would be up to the tax advisors to report those. So you, as a fund manager, you may want to liaise with your tax advisor and verify whether they will report those structures or not. If you didn't have any tax advisor, obviously, the responsibility to report would fall on you. And the next slide, I just have, just a quick word on the hallmarks. So we have in the annex of the directive, we have 15 hallmarks and then with a number of sub hallmarks. So overall, there are like 30 points of control of aggressiveness of a tax arrangement. They are categorized into five categories. I will not go through all of them, but very quickly, if you look at the category A hallmarks, these are generic hallmarks linked to the main benefit test. So there has to have a tax motivation behind the arrangement. And here we capture structures or arrangements that where there is, for instance, a confidentiality clause that would prevent an advisor, an intermediary to report that scheme or to disclose the scheme to the tax authorities. Or for instance, where there is a success fee that is linked to the amount of the tax advantage obtained. Then we have category B hallmarks, specific hallmarks linked to the main benefit test. Here we have examples or cases such as an acquisition of a loss-making company, not with the intention to continue the operation of the company, but with the intention to discontinue the operations to utilize the tax losses. We also have something that is quite important, especially for the alternative fund industry. We have a hallmark that, according to which, if income is converted to another category of income that is taxed at a lower rate, this would also potentially be reportable on DAC 6. Then we have category C hallmarks. For instance, we have deductible cross-border payments to associated companies, associated enterprises that are so deductible in one jurisdiction and not taxed or taxed at a lower rate in another jurisdiction, under the condition that this kind of transaction is has as a motivation to obtain the tax advantage. Then we have also under category C hallmarks, we have payments to stateless entities or state entities that are resident in non-cooperative jurisdictions. We have things such as depreciation of the same asset into several jurisdictions, so multiple times, that kind of stuff. And then we have category D hallmarks. These are linked to basically CRS. Whenever you have an investor that is, that wants to circumvent or wants to avoid being disclosed for CRS, you in principle would need to report that investor for DEXIX purposes, or if you have an investor that claims a specific CRS status that in your view is not correct, you may also want to report that as well. And then we have the last category, transfer pricing linked hallmarks. Here we have, I briefly alluded to that earlier on, but here we have cases where you have a transfer of functions, corporate reorganizations that result into significant decrease of operating income and therefore the taxable base in a given jurisdiction. You may have cases of transfers of hard to value intangibles. This would trigger also reporting under DEXIX. So that's it when it comes to this topic. I also have on the next slide a very quick update on withholding tax. So in four jurisdictions, these are recent updates. In Denmark, we have new rules for investment funds that are effective since 1st of January 2020. These rules will ease access to the Danish retail market for foreign equity-based investment funds. So under the new rules, investment funds may opt to be considered equity-based. That means that general investment income is taxed as either equity income or capital income. By opting to be considered as equity-based, a fund will allow their Danish investors to be taxed under a much more favorable tax regime. So there is a number of requirements for an investment fund to qualify as equity-based. But the main one is that the fund has to be invested in equities for more than 50% of its assets. In Korea, and this is a very recent update we have, on 16 January, we had the South Korean Supreme Court that ruled that Luxembourg SICAVs should be entitled to reduced withholding tax rates on interest and dividends under the Korea and Luxembourg tax treaty. To give you a bit more background on this one, so before 2011, Luxembourg SICAVs used to have treaty access, but then that access was removed by the Korean Ministry of Finance, that basically argued that Luxembourg SICAVs are not tax residents of Luxembourg within the meaning of the treaty. And therefore, the Ministry of Finance removed the treaty access, but also with retroactive effects back to 2006. So litigation was initiated in 2012. There was a positive decision by the Court of First Instance a couple of years after that. There was another positive decision by the Court of Appeals a couple of years after. And very recently, we also had the last level of appeal, the Supreme Court, that also ruled favorably in favor of Luxembourg SICAVs, meaning that this decision is now final. So going forward, Luxembourg will have access to the Korea Luxembourg tax treaty. So 15% on dividends and 10% on the interest income from Korean sources. In Belgium, we have a similar case. So the Court of Appeals of Brussels concluded that Luxembourg SICAVs should have access to treaty benefits with Belgium. The decision was not really related to withholding tax, but to a very specific tax regime, which is a wealth tax that applies to non-Belgian funds with Belgian investor base. According to the judgment of the Court of Appeals, the taxing right for that tax should have been allocated to Luxembourg under the Belgium tax treaty. In order to reach that conclusion, the court explicitly stated that Luxembourg should be eligible to treaty benefits under the Belgium-Luxembourg tax treaty. By extension, this also means that Luxembourg SICAV should be able to benefit from the treaty rates for withholding tax purposes. So there is this was a decision by the Court of Appeals. The case is now pending with the Belgian Supreme Court. We are expecting the final decision to take place this year or next year. And last but not least, a quick update, not on withholding tax, but on a capital gains tax. This is also very relevant for investment funds. So we have the Indian Budget 2020 that was presented to the Indian Parliament on the 1st of February 2020. So this is still a proposal, and it has to be approved by both houses in Indian Parliament and sent by the President of India. But basically what we have in the proposal is that there will be, contrary to the demands of the industry and expectations from the industry, there will be no change to the capital gains tax, meaning that the current regime and the current rates for short-term and long-term capital gains will continue to apply. However, we will have an abolition of the dividend distribution tax, or the DTT. It is proposed to abolish the DDT and replace it by a proper withholding tax mechanism the rate of which will be 20%. And something else that is relevant for sovereign wealth funds, there is now a favorable regime, so basically an exemption on Indian source, exemption of withholding tax on Indian source income paid to sovereign wealth funds that invest in the Indian infrastructure facilities. So that's basically it from my end.
Perfect. Thank you so much for that, Nenad. So I suppose that brings our session for today to a close. I really do want to thank you all for taking the time to join us today. As you can see, there are many developments on a tax front. In particular, I imagine the impact of Brexit on withholding tax is something many of you have had to have questions on and been dealing with recently. So I do hope you found that session useful. Also, in relation to DAC 6, I think it is just key to remember that that has retroactive application. So as we've mentioned throughout today's session, that goes back to the 25th of June 2018, which is quite some time ago. You know, I'm not sure how many of us remember what we did 2 weeks ago, let alone in 2018. So I suppose the earlier you can start thinking about that, casting your mind back to what kind of happened in the last while, what kind of arrangements you may need to report, the better, because I suppose that those dates in the summer for the reporting are going to come upon us very quickly. As I mentioned, the Irish guidance on how to report hasn't come out yet. As Nenad had mentioned, the Luxembourg law hasn't even come out yet. So we are going to have to deal with it quite quickly when it does come out. So any preparation you can do now would be really, really helpful in that regard. And of course, we're here for any questions that you might have on that. I suppose then more generally, should you have any questions on today's session, please do not hesitate to contact your local Deloitte engagement team. We'd all be very, very happy to advise you further. And then maybe just a quick point on our next session. So this will take place on the 5th of March. It's going to cover culture and corporate governance. We really hope you'll all join us there. And until then, it's goodbye and thank you from all of us. Bye.